Good afternoon. How's everyone tonight? We welcome you to Kingsway family. God bless you. Come on, I think God has something prepared for us tonight as we worship and come into unity together, that it's going to release a great anointing over us. God's going to release peace and joy tonight. So Father, in Jesus' name, we lift up your name. Holy Spirit, come and fill this place in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you.
just for you.
It's for you, it's all for you, God.
Oh, the dead man and the cynical too, they're coming out of their grave, and it's just for you. The love of God is stronger. The love of God is stronger than the power of the grave.
Yeah.
Oh, your love, oh God, is stronger. Your love, oh God, is stronger. Your love, oh God, is stronger. Your love is strong. stronger. Your love is stronger, Jesus. Strong, so much greater. Beautiful one,
Son of Man, beautiful one, you're changing me from the inside out. Loving the one who raised me up from death to life, from wrong to right. You're making all things beautiful. Oh, I will awake and spend my days loving the one who raised me up from death to life, from wrong to right. You're making all things beautiful. You're making all things beautiful. You're making all things beautiful.
Coming alive.
Everything you touch, everything you look upon is beautiful to you. Oh, you make us beautiful. Revives the sick and lame. Your power wakes the dead again. Your love destroys the grip of sin. Your word commands the winds and waves. Wakes the dead again. Yeah. Your love destroys the grip of sin. Oh, your love destroys the grip of sin. And there's no other name, the name Jesus, like yours, Jesus. There's no other name. There's no other name like yours, Jesus. Like yours, Jesus. There's no other name. There's no other name like yours, Jesus. Like yours, Jesus. There's no other name. There's no other name like yours, Jesus. Like yours, Jesus. There's no other name. there's no other name like yours, Jesus, like yours, Jesus. There's no other name, there's no other name like yours, Jesus, like yours, Jesus. No, there's no other name, there's no other name like yours, Jesus, like yours, Jesus. No other name can change a life forever. No other name can save us. Oh, what a name, Jesus, what a name, Jesus. And all generations will sing of your goodness, and all generations will know your name. Oh, glory and honor will be yours forever. Oh, glory and honor we give to your name. All generations will sing of your goodness. All generations will know your name. Our glory and honor will be yours forever. Our glory and honor we give to your name. All generations will sing of your goodness. All generations will know your name. Our glory. Glory to the name of Jesus.
Psalm 145. I will extol you, my God, O King, and I will bless your name forever and ever. Every day, every day, every day I will bless you, and I will praise your name forever and ever. Great is the Lord, and greatly to be praised, and his greatness is unsearchable. One generation shall praise your works to another and shall declare your mighty acts. I will meditate on the glorious splendor of your majesty and on your wondrous works. Men shall speak of the might of your awesome acts, and I will declare your greatness. They shall utter the memory of your great goodness and shall sing of your righteousness. The Lord is gracious and full of compassion, slow to anger and great in mercy. The Lord is good to all. You know, history may not remember my name, Jeff Watley. Maybe it will. But there's one name that stands the test of the ages. The beautiful name that rang out in the beginning of time that still has power to set the captive free. It still has power to break off every single chain. It still has power to awaken a dead and sleeping heart. There's power in that name of Jesus. And it doesn't matter how great darkness gets. The power of Jesus' name is so awesome, so mighty. And we give it power in our life when we acknowledge, great is the Lord. The Lord is gracious, slow to anger, rich in mercy. He's good to all, not just some, not just some, not just some. He's good to every person. His goodness is unsearchable tonight. Whatever you need, whatever you need. Father, we release the power of the beautiful name of Jesus. It's more than a word, it's more than a label. It's a melody that was spoken forth out of your heart. Your beautiful son that came and gave all that he was so that we could live, and all of that, the gift to humanity was your son that was given so that we could live in authority and in power. And God, we release the power of the name in this place of Jesus. I declare and decree over every person tonight, those that have been held in bondage, those that have been held captive, I speak right now to the spirit of depression. I speak right now to the spirit of addiction. Right now, every stronghold has to bow its knee to the mighty name of Jesus. Because there is no other name. There is no other name. There is no other name. Come on. Jesus.
Oh. There's no other name. There's no other name like yours. Jesus. Like yours. Jesus. Like yours, Jesus. There's no other name. There's no other name like yours, Jesus. Like yours, Jesus. There's no other name. There's no other name. There's no other name like yours, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Somebody thank him in the house tonight. Jesus. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Lord. You know, I told the staff at our prayer on Tuesday a story that I remembered from when I went to Jackson Hole, Wyoming. Me and my father-in-law had an all-expense trip paid. And as we got off the plane, the beautiful Grand Teton Mountains were the most majestic and beautiful thing I'd ever seen. We come from the flatlands where you can see for miles and miles and miles. It's a sight in itself. But I remember standing for hours and just looking up, gaping open, just the most majestic thing I'd ever seen. And we couldn't take it in enough. And I remember that night we went to this really expensive steakhouse, and the waitress was waiting on us. And I said, how in the world? I said, do you ever get used to this kind of beauty? And she said, oh, I never even notice anymore. And I just wonder, it's a choice. It's a choice to live in awe of the majestic beauty of God. And I never want to pass Him so casually. I never want to not stand at the base of my God and look up and just see this great big smile looking at me, loving me, creating me to be everything, empowering me to be everything that He's called me to be. May I always live awestruck by the One who is. That mountain, as beautiful as it was only creation giving a small glimpse of the majesty of my God. It was just creation giving a small little inkling to when I stand at the base of my God and I look on Him and I see His splendor and I see His beauty, church. We have a choice. We have a choice to live in awe. And I just wonder if there's a people in Birmingham, Alabama that says, you know what? We won't just pass by you anymore, God. We won't just walk so busy with our life or doing what we do every single day, the mundane and all of these things. But whatever we do, we will stand and we will keep our eyes focused on true beauty, on real majesty. Could you just take a moment tonight and look upon Him? I want you to be stirred in your heart. See Him. See His love for you tonight. See His arms outstretched to you tonight. Who is man? Who is man that God is mindful, but yet He is? He's mindful of you tonight. He's acquainted. The truth is, God has stood at the base of your mountain. And He's looked upon you and He said, you're beautiful. You're beautiful. Not because of your own strength, but because His Son paid a high price for every single person. He marvels at your beauty. He marvels at your beauty tonight. God is looking at you tonight and He's saying, look at what a good work we did. I just see Him nudging Holy Spirit saying, hey, look at what we did. Look at what we created. These are my sons and my daughters. These are my sons and my daughters. Just look at them. Thank you, Jesus. Father, I just declare over us tonight, Lord. Let it start in me, God. I want to live a life of awe. I want to live a life, God, in love with You, in love with all that You are, God, with every ounce of my being awakened, Lord, to Your majesty and Your beauty and Your goodness, God. I love You, Jesus. I love You, Jesus. I love You, Jesus, with all of my heart, all of my soul, all of my strength. I love You. I love You. I love You. I love You. I love You, Jesus. I love You, Jesus. Thank You. Could you give Him a clap of praise tonight? Hallelujah. 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 I believe we're in a season where people are going to get beside themselves. And I believe, even as David said, look, you think I'm undignified now, you're just seeing the fringe of it. And I'm telling you, there's a weighty glory that's on your being undone. I can't wait to see it. I can't. It's going to be good. Why don't you do this tonight? Find somebody and just give them a great, great big hug and just say, hey, I'm so glad you're here.
Amen. Amen. Isn't our God good? Man, come on. Come on. Let's thank God again for his presence. Man, just the sweet, sweet presence of God is in the house tonight. Thank you, Jesus. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Come on, let's just thank God again for his presence. Man, in his presence is fullness of joy and life and love and peace. And we're just, we're so excited and honored that God is here tonight. But we're also excited and honored for our guests tonight. If you're a first-time visitor here at Kingsway Church, if you would just hold your hand up nice and high for us, please. Any first-time guests in the house tonight, our ushers have some cards, some Connect cards that they're going to be putting in your hands right now. If you would take a few moments during the next few announcements, make sure and fill out that information. If you have any prayer requests that you want us to be agreeing with you about, please make sure and put that prayer request on there. Make sure we have your phone number so we can call you and pray with you. And just thank you again personally for joining us at Kingsway this evening. Also, if you'll put your email address on there, we're going to send you an email with a link to it where you can have a digital download to get some of this amazing Kingsway worship just as a blessing and saying thank you for making Kingsway your home tonight. We like to say you come as a guest the first time, but now you're actually family. So the rest of the Kingsway family, let's thank God for all the guests that are in the house tonight. We're so honored to have you this evening. Now, if we could have the King's Kids grades 1 through 5 come on up front and join us down here. Come on, let's thank God for these awesome sons and daughters of God. Come on, man. This is a great, great looking group up here. Look at them. They just keep coming. Praise the Lord. After a long day at school and homeschool and all kinds of chores, man, they are excited here tonight, ready to learn from the Lord. We have a very special announcement tonight. We have a birthday girl in the house tonight. Come on. Miss Ava Watley turned 7 years old today. Come on. Let's thank God for Ava and the gift that she is. The Kingsway Church. Woo, woo, woo. I'm not going to sing happy birthday to you, Ava, because I don't want to ruin the song for you. But happy birthday from Kingsway. Before we pray over the kids in just a minute and release them to an awesome time tonight, man, what an amazing group stretching across the front here. This morning, as I was in prayer, driving to go to Irondale Middle School with our amazing youth team to love on some students right in our backyard again, I was praying for our King's kids, and I was praying for all the nursery workers and for all the leaders. And I was praying over their identity and over their destiny. I was asking the Lord to show all of the leaders of our King's kids the purpose and the plans and the destiny that God has for every single kid. And while I was praying, the Lord showed me a picture of these little bags of seeds. And he wanted me to stop and to buy some and to give them to Pastor Tina. And when she walked in a few minutes ago, I gave her a whole bunch of a variety of packs of seeds, and she slipped them in her purse. And I said, I'm going to tell you why I'm giving you these in just a little bit. But I believe what the Lord was saying, that this is for our nursery workers as a shadow and type, as a symbol. Now, to the untrained eye, you need a packet. I need a packet. I can't tell the seeds apart. Some of you experienced gardeners, I know Pastor Tina, Pastor Sonny, many of you do raised beds. You can probably look at a seed and go, you know what? I know what that finished product is supposed to be. But if you're like me, I need to know the end from the beginning. And I was believing that the Lord was saying that every one of these kids are unique like these seeds. And that the Lord is going to show our leaders a picture of the purpose and the plans and the destiny that God has for every single one of you guys. And I've learned some things about gardening from my wife. She'll take a soil sample to see if it's healthy to even plant the seeds and know when the time is right to plant the seeds. She even knows what seeds to plant next to each other, because you think something may grow next to each other, but it actually pulls nutrients away and actually can stunt the growth. So God is going to show our leaders the relationships that need to happen and who needs to be planted next to one another and build relationships and friendships as King's kids and partner as they go forward on their destiny. And we're going to nurture those seeds. We're going to see those seeds watered. And you know what? The Bible says that you will be called, you guys will be like oaks of righteousness, like trees of righteousness, the planting of the Lord, that you guys are going to bring forth incredible fruit as you guys meditate and think about the Word of God all of your days. And I thank God for these leaders that are pouring the Word of God into you. Thanks for being patient as I've been talking up here. If you guys would just stretch forth your hands over these men, you know what? I see a nice, rich, fertile soil beneath your feet. And I see you guys planting down deep in there. And the gardener, the leaders are being very careful to plant you guys deep in the heart of the Word of God. And you guys are going to bring forth incredible life. This worship, the rain of the Holy Spirit, is like the rain that comes. And then when you feel the presence of Jesus, that's like the sunshine. And it's going to cause you guys to grow and do mighty things for Him as your identity is sealed and your destiny is revealed. So be blessed tonight. Be released to King's kids and have an awesome night. Come on, let's thank God for these trees of righteousness, the planting of the Lord. Come on, what a great looking group. Man, I almost want to run out with them and just hang out with those warriors. Hey, this Friday, we want to call you guys' attention to a very special announcement. This Friday from 7 a.m. until 8 a.m. on 93.7 WDJC, Pastor Jason has the opportunity to minister to thousands over the airwaves in the city of Birmingham. And we just are praying and believing that God is going to release the word of the Lord and the voice of the Lord and stir up and awaken Birmingham's prophetic destiny for this hour, because Birmingham is positioned for awakening and reformation. So you guys lift him up in prayer. Turn on the radio, listen and agree, and just, man, just imagine the hearts that are going to be stirred and pricked all over the city of Birmingham. It's like I see people as they're in their cars driving, and all of a sudden they're just weeping because they feel the perfect love of God, which casts out all of their fear. As they're sitting there in their cubicle, and all of a sudden they begin to crank it up, and they begin to pray in the Spirit, and all of a sudden the coworker comes over, and they're able to minister to their coworker. And man, there's a connection here at Kingsway. So let's thank God for that, and make sure and pray and tune in. And man, it's going to be an awesome, awesome time. We have a few more announcements, but if you'll turn your attention to the video screen, we've got some video announcements tonight. Bless you guys.
Hey, Kingsway family. We're so excited that you've joined us tonight. We have a few announcements for you that you might want to know about. Yes, ladies, we want to remind you that every Friday at 10 a.m. we will be having our women's Bible study in the fellowship hall with Pastor Tina as she talks about being powerful and free. We definitely want to see you there.
Also, Sunday, right after our 11 a.m. service, we're going to be having our third Pathways class where we will be having an amazing fellowship meal, also providing you with a unique spiritual gifts assessment, helping you to discover your personal pathway to God's purpose for your life. We'd love to see you there.
Yes, and Kingsway men, get excited because Friday, February 3rd at 6 a.m., we'll be having our next All the King's Men Pray Breakfast. We'll be having a hearty breakfast as we learn how to be fathers, husbands, and men in the kingdom of God.
Yes, and students, we're so excited about the youth worship nights we're going to be having in 2017. Be sure and mark your calendars because our next one is going to be on Friday, February 17th. We're going to be having pizza at 6 and an amazing time of worship at 7. Be sure and bring your friends. We'd love to see you there.
Thanks again for joining us. Please enjoy the rest of the service.
Did y'all know that David and Aaron are twins? How many of y'all know that? Huh? Anybody not know that? Now you do. Come on now. What? That's right. Hey, also, you know, Richard was actually in the kitchen Sunday morning when I was talking about just the labor of love that he and his team and Janie and Ellen and everybody else had poured out last week for our wonderful fellowship meal. How many of you enjoyed the chili and the cornbread and the salad and just all that? Listen, they've been in there already slaving away for this coming Sunday. And I just wanted us to thank Janie and Richard and Ellen and Sarah and so many that have been back there preparing. So thankful. And, you know, Richard's a very busy guy, of course, you know, owns and operates Alabama Heating and Cooling. And it's rare to be able to find somebody who can and will just take off days at a time just to be able to come and serve in the kitchen. Amen. And just such a blessing to so many. So I want to be sure we honored him. Hey, do me a favor. Jeff Schatz, come on up here. We were having lunch today and Jeff was sharing with Pastor Jeff and Pastor Jody something he had seen a couple Wednesdays ago. And I thought it'd be an encouragement to you as we prepare our hearts to receive our offering tonight. Jeff, what did you see?
Uh-oh. Looks like you got a surprise now.
I do. All right. As most of y'all know, I don't like being up here. But Jason knows how to stretch me. Let me get this up. This week at work, I got a request from my college roommate's daughter plays tennis at Snead State. She requested a donation. So I went, you know, I always send her something. This is her second year. And I went to look at an old check register, see what I sent last year. As I was looking through my desk, I was trying to find it. And I didn't find it, but I found this. If I can, here we go. I didn't know I was going to get, I got to share this last night as well at my men's Bible study, but it says, let me get these on. It says, God sees us through the redeemed blood of Christ. He doesn't see us. He doesn't see all of our imperfections. He knows what they are, but doesn't let that keep his love from filling us. The worse we are, the more grace he offers. Everyone doesn't need the same measure of grace, but we all receive the same amount of love. We are all heirs to the same fortune. Well, that fortune that I had, and I don't know where that came from. It was just folded up. I had written it down at some point. I don't think it came from me, but who knows? It could have. But I got to thinking. Yeah. I didn't know I was going to get to. Like I said, I kept it. I took a picture of it, so because I sent it. A couple of people needed to hear that this week. And then Wednesday night, before the men's prayer breakfast, whatever that was, as I was during worship, I noticed right in this area a huge hourglass. I mean, enormous hourglass. And instead of sand, it had gold. And it was filtering down through there. And it was, as I kept seeing that, I kept hearing, it's time to prosper. It's time to prosper. And I told them that today at lunch. And Jason texted me about the time I drove up in the driveway. And he sent me this picture. It's a Chuck Pierce book, A Time to Prosper. And he said it was kind of, when he was sitting in his office, it was kind of sticking out.
Hanging out, yeah.
And he handed it. I hadn't read it yet, of course, because he hadn't either, I don't think. But we're, but anyway, I think that, yeah, I think that's a word for us as a house, as a city. Is it is time for us to prosper, and it's time for us to take up the swords. I don't know if you noticed today, the Andrew, the guy that was cleaning the table, last at the men's breakfast, Jody was talking about taking up your swords and fighting, and it was today, and I was, as Andrew, he works at Tzatziki's, he's special needs, but he was talking about going to Orlando with his father, and they were going to, and he loved Darth Vader and the Star Wars, and he started doing the swords, and he was going to, and they're talking about lightsabers. And it really, you know, it is time. It's time for us to take up our swords and take up what, and the war, you know, take it to this world. I mean, it's the other thing I saw going to lunch was a truck pulled up beside me. I'd already talked to Jason the night before. I said, what are we going to talk about? I've already told him everything I know in about 10 minutes. So on the way, a red truck pulls up beside me. On the side of it is the words, J-E-S-U-S, big letters. Only thing on the truck. I took a picture of it, and I was like, this is, I said, I guess that's what we're going to talk about. So, and then they were singing tonight. That's all they were singing about. So that's really what it's all about. It's all about Jesus. It's not about us. It's not about, you know, it's not about fortune. You know, the fortune I had was, you know, Jesus, he's the fortune. And I'm just so thankful for that. And I'm thankful for all of y'all. Thank y'all.
I want you to pray for everybody. I'm going to read this first and then pray. Hey, I really felt like Jeff had something of an authority to release, because how many of you know when you see something, you actually have the revelation and the authority to release what you've seen, amen? And when he had said that, it reminded me of a scripture. They're going to put it up on the screen out of the Passion Translation. How many of you love the Passion Translation? So excited Brian Simmons is going to be with us in August, but Proverbs 11, 24 and 25 in the Passion Translation says this. It says, generosity brings prosperity, but withholding from charity brings poverty. Those who live to bless others will have blessings heaped upon them. And the one who pours out his life to pour out blessings will be saturated with favor. Come on, I'm gonna read that again. Those who live to bless others. How many of you live to bless others? How many of you know it really is better to give than to receive? Will have blessings heaped upon them. That's like dump trucks. Beep, 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 bam. And the one who pours out his life to pour out blessings will be saturated with favor. Amen. And I felt like that was just a very appropriate verse tonight as we give to the Lord as an extension of our worship. And so I just want you to take a moment right now and pray about what the Lord would have you to do and what he would have you to give. The translation that many of us are familiar with as it relates to that scripture is Proverbs 11, 24 in the King James, where it says that there is one who scatters yet increases. And how many tell you that the wisdom of this world says you scatter, you got less, but the wisdom of heaven says you scatter and you increase. It says he who withholds more than is right, it leads to poverty. In other words, when we hold on to what we have, how many of you know it begins to dwindle and begin to run out? But when we're generous, God allows us to become a conduit of his kingdom to bring a blessing to those around us. And it goes on to say the generous soul will be made rich. That word rich isn't just about money. It means fat, anointed, and become prosperous. It says he who waters will then himself be watered. And we have an opportunity here on the earth to pour out of what God has so richly poured into so many of us. And he promises that as we pour out in the natural, that he'll open up the windows of heaven and pour out a blessing that we can't contain. Amen. So go ahead and stand to your feet tonight with your offering. I'm going to ask Jeff just to pray over you and to pray over the offering tonight. I feel like there's a real anointing for increase and for multiplication. The same God who supplies the seed multiplies it when it's sown and increases the fruit of your righteousness. Amen. Just allow your faith to begin to rise tonight. How many of you believe it's time to prosper? Let's declare that. Say, it's my time to prosper. It's my time to prosper. You see, Psalm 35, 27 says he takes pleasure in the prosperity of his servants. God desires that we prosper because in and through us, the whole earth will be blessed. Amen. Jeff, release what's in your heart.
Dear Lord, I just thank you. I thank you for all your blessings.
Yes.
Thank you for just overflowing blessings, Lord, in my life that I have so greatly appreciate, Lord. And I just ask that you do the same for each and every one of these people here.
Yes.
Lord, just show them your power. Show them your strength, Lord. Lord, I just thank you. Thank you for your son. Thank you, Jesus. Lord, thank you.
Amen. Come on down. Let's minister to the Lord in our giving. Come on, let's worship him.
His only throne across ocean, Jesus, Jesus. To the Lamb of God who knows me by my name, all the glory, all the honor, all the confusing too. It just gets stranger by the day, but that's okay. I've been the blind man on the road, and I've been the boy running back home. I've been the sinner and the saint, but the love of God has never changed. Of
Come on, everybody. Come on. There's something of a shift in the room right now. Come on. I just feel the Lord beginning to impart faith to hearts right now. How many of you have something in your life right now that is way too big for you to hold? Right now, I just want you to see yourself holding that thing. And just take a deep breath in. And as you exhale, just say, I trust you, God. And let go. Just let go of it right now. Whatever it is. He's big enough. He loves you more than enough. And his grace is more than sufficient. I trust you, God. I release it to you, Father. Jesus' name. Amen. Hey, let's thank the Lord for Steve and for Aaron and for Ben and for David. So thankful, this amazing family. Thank the Lord for Jill. Come on now. The Holy Ghost glue. Come on, keeps it all together. Amen. Hey, we're going to go ahead and release our junior high and senior high youth right out the back of the sanctuary. You guys have a special treat tonight. Not only they got awesome snacks and trivia, but Pastors Jeff and Suzanne are going to be teaching the junior high, and I believe Ben and Ashton, come on now, have a word that's burning in their hearts for the senior high as well. And how many of you are thankful what God is doing through the youth ministry here? Just awesome. So, so proud of our leaders and our students and just what God is doing. I'll tell you, my boys are, what are you doing? You joking me? Huh? Okay. Yeah, joke him, don't joke me. She was like, make me think Chris Farley. Come on now. In a van down by the river. So, anyway, if you're too sanctified to know what that is, God bless you. Amen. So, I thank God I'm saved, but I wasn't always saved. All right. Hey, but we have some amazing treats tonight. Honestly, we are a very gifted house. The gifts, the grace, the treasures, the talents that God has deposited in this place. One of the reasons I'm so excited about Pathways this Sunday is Pastor Jody and the team have been working on this skills assessment, this gifts testing to help to begin to mine out all of the gifts and all of the treasures that God has deposited in this house and in this family. And tonight we have just two incredible gifts to this body. You're going to hear in a moment from Pastor John Purcell. Going to be back. Come on now. Bringing a powerful word called It's Your Season. Say, it's my season. But we have someone first, Jada Reaves. Come on up, Jada. Jada and her family, kind of new to Kingsway family. You guys been here, what, about 3 months? Yeah. And I've just seen so much of the Lord in Jada since the very first time I met her and her husband. And I'm like, man, this girl is exploding with God. And I asked her a couple weeks ago, I said, would you share this Wednesday? And I'm telling you, I am so excited and expecting for what God has placed in you. Amen. So just have liberty, have freedom, and release what you got. Have fun.
I've never been told I have 10 minutes. So we'll see how this goes. No, I think I can get it all said in 10 minutes, but... Yes, I'm Jada, and my husband is Morgan, and he's actually in Mobile tonight, so he's not here, but he's probably watching. Hey. Anyway, I am going to talk about a heart prepared. Amen. And a heart prepared for God's glory. And when Pastor Jason actually asked me to speak, it was sort of funny because he asked me in passing, like we saw each other for a split second, and I said yes. And then I was like, whoa, wait, what did I just do? But I knew it was God. I knew I was supposed to be there because everything had been fighting me that day not to be there. And so I knew I was supposed to be there in that moment. Amen. And I knew I was supposed to share this because this is what God has had on my heart. The past few months, I've just been really, I just felt a fire inside my heart rekindled. I've just felt more alive than I have felt in just a couple years, just a fire that's just been rekindled in my soul. And I was praying the other day. I'm a stay-at-home mom. I have a 15-month-old. Her name is Cadence. And I was on my way home from somewhere, and I was like, God, why can't I just stay in this place? Lord, you know, would like my flesh is out of the way, and I'm just in your holy of holies, and nothing else matters but you, Lord, and I don't have to worry about, you know, screaming at anybody or getting mad. Like, I'm just in your presence. Just keep me here. Please don't make me go back, you know? And the Lord began to speak to me out of that, because it was really pure heart. Like, God, I just want to stay here forever. I just want to stay here. And then I began to pray. I go, God, prepare my heart for your glory. And I was like, why am I praying for God to prepare my heart for his glory? Doesn't his glory just come? Like, I was confused as to why I was praying that, but God had a significant purpose in the reason I was praying, And I just began to pray it all week. I just felt, God, prepare my heart for your glory. Prepare my heart for what you have in my life and my family's life. Lord, prepare me. Whatever that is, prepare my heart for it. And as I prayed that, I was actually this past weekend, the past couple days, I have been in Mobile, and I was praying on my way there, and I was like, God, just prepare me. Prepare me for whatever it is you have to say. And I had my eyes closed, and I was just praying, and I just saw an ocean. I saw an ocean, and I think this is for you guys because it was what I was praying for Kingsway, so I really feel like this is for us all. But I was praying, and all of a sudden, I saw myself, and we were under an ocean, and I was walking. I was walking under the ocean in like this underwater cave, and the water was so light, I could walk in it. I didn't have to swim, but I felt the pressure of it on top of me, and the Holy Spirit spoke to me, and he said, the weight, it doesn't take much to walk where I've called you to walk. But it takes my permission and my authority to be able to get the glory that I've got in store for you. Like, it takes preparation for what I've got in store for you. And so that, to me, like, the water represented his love and his grace and his salvation. And that's available to us all. That's available to every single one of us. But his glory and the glory that I was asking for and the heart that I was asking for is something that's going to have to be prepared. And it kind of scared me because I'm like, Lord, I started watching, got all excited, and I started watching these YouTube videos of underwater caves and all these different, I was like, good Lord, those look terrifying. Like, what does the ocean do under there? Like, I don't, God, why did you give me that vision? I don't want to be under there, you know? And he just said, you can't ask for a prepared heart without complete surrender. And I was like, oh, Jesus, you know, Lord, I know you're here and I know you're standing with me, but that's really scary. And he was like, that's what I have in store for my people. Jada, you're asking for this, but do you realize what you're asking for? You're asking for my glory, but what's in store? What I have, what's in store for your family's life and for your life and where you're asking me to take you is going to take my complete trust. And everybody can swim in the water, but not everybody can walk in my glory. Consistently, always. And I was like, well, that's got to relate to being in the Holy of Holies and not ever, you know, of course we all get in our flesh, but staying in that frame of mind more than not. Is getting to that place where it's complete surrender. God, I don't know where this is taking me, and I have no reason why I'm walking here, and I'm not even supposed to be walking here, but you're walking right here with me, and I have no idea why, but I know it's you. And I felt that, and then God just brought to my, he was giving me this vision. It was all happening at one time, and the scripture of Habakkuk 2:14, it says, the knowledge of my glory will cover the earth as the waters cover the sea. And then he said this. He said, Jada, you know, my yoke is easy and my burden is light. But the deeper I went, the more pressure of the water I began to feel. He said, the weight of my glory requires preparation. He said, I'll take and show you things you've asked for. I'll keep you in the Holy of Holies. But are you prepared for the dedication of what that'll take? And I just said, equip me, God, send me. And I can remember being in high school. I'm only 23, so I'm not that old. But I can remember being in high school, and I can remember praying, God, send me, use me, Lord. Give me the heart for my generation. God, I want to see revival. God, I want to see these streets. God, this school just laid out in you. I want to see prayer. I want to see, God, this public school system, St. Clair County. Like, I mean, I was big. I mean, praying, first priority, I was all about it. And I prayed it, and I was for real. Like, on my face, God, whatever it takes, I will do it. And I didn't realize what I was asking for when I prayed that. Because God began to wake me up in the middle of the night. And I would just hear the prayers and the cries of my classmates. And I would feel their heart and I would feel his heart. And he's like, I'm breaking my heart for what breaks yours. Because you asked me for my glory. And you asked me for this, Jada. And you got to be prepared for what it takes. And I would walk in that school and I'd give God. And this is now, this is as a mom, but this in that season that I was in, I can remember saying, my problems, any issues I have, stay here at the door, because this classroom and this school is my mission field. And God, however many people can get set on fire for you today, that's what it's going to take. And I saw God do miraculous things. I saw God do miraculous things. I'm still seeing God do miraculous things. But it was in that moment that he took me back and he said, see, when you ask for things like this, what it takes. Because as I was walking and I was under that ocean and I was looking at all these things, you know, the ocean moves and there's volcanoes under the ocean and there's earthquakes under the ocean, which causes tsunamis and islands and all these things. And as I was watching all that take place, he said, but this is what you asked me for. And I really firmly believe that God is looking for a people that says, God, whatever, whatever it takes. Whatever it takes, I'm willing to go. God, I don't care how scary this looks. I don't care how impossible the situation is. God, I'm going to walk in full authority with you. And I believe that this is this people. I believe that God placed us here, that God placed me here, because this is a people that's willing to say, God, I don't care what it takes. I'm going where you send me. And I look around at the world. And I look around at all the women's march and all these things that are going on around us. And I see the turmoil and I see all this and I just look and I just think, God, but you said, though the hills be shaken and the mountains be removed, that we will not be shaken and that our covenant of peace won't be removed. And God, so I'm standing in the midst of all this and I know that there's a revival. I know that there's a stirring in the atmosphere. I know that there's a stirring in the presence of God. That he's getting ready to do something. He's getting ready to take us somewhere, or else all this wouldn't be around us. And I close my eyes and I just see him. And I can remember, and I'm about to close, but I can remember being a little girl. And God knows the place he's taken me from and just being ripped to shreds because, you know, I had a mom and dad that dealt with addiction and their addiction bled over into my life and foster homes and all these things that happened. And I can remember feeling so alone and just cuddled up like, God, who? Nobody wants me. I'm abandoned. I'm alone. No one cares. No one knows my name. And I just felt as a six-year-old little girl, I would feel his arms wrap around me and I'd feel him say, but I have you and I'm not letting you go. And I feel like that's what he's saying to his people, that there's all this going on. And if we just abide in that place, if we just stay in that place with him, he will take us to play. We won't be even worried about what's going on around us. We don't care all the things that are falling because God is right there and he is our calm and steady. And I believe that. And I want God to take me there. I just turned off the YouTube videos and I was like, God, I don't care what it looks like. Take me to that underwater cave. I want to feel the weight of your glory and I want to swim in the lightness of your love. God, I want you. I just want you. I just want you. And I believe that. I believe we all just want him. And I believe that right now. And I'm just going to pray that as I close. It says, God said to me too, as I was wrapping up this message, he said, be careful what you ask for because you just might get it. And I was like, oh, thank you, Jesus. That is so awesome. Yes, God, right now, Lord, we pray, God. We pray right now, Father God, just for a revelation knowledge. God, take us to that place of your glory, God, where we can, God, we can be in the lightness of your love, God, where we can just be there, Lord, but we'll feel the weight of your glory. God, I pray, God, that you give us permission. God, give us that authority to walk with your glory in a place that we've never gone before, Father, because our hearts are ready and they're prepared and they're open to see all that you have in store for us. God, and I pray, Lord, that each and every person in this place is not, God, they were not here by mistake. And Lord, I pray, God, that you speak to them this week, that you begin to give them dreams, that you begin to give them visions, God, that you begin to give them your heart, because that is what we're asking for. Yes. And I praise you for that, Lord, and I thank you for that, Jesus. Yes. In your name we pray, amen.
Amen. Yeah. 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 I'm so proud of you. Good job, you brought it. How many of you want to hear some more from Jada? Come on now. Yeah, you're going to be. Listen, you know, that was, how many of you know Jesus' prayers get answered? You know, in John 17, he prayed that the same glory the Father had given to him would come to us. Amen? We're called to carry that glory. We're called to not just walk in and out. We're called to walk in and to carry it with us where we go. Amen? And as Jada was sharing, I just kept hearing in Psalm 42, deep calls unto deep. How many of you felt something stirring in your spirit? I'm telling you, there was impartation, not just information. There was a spirit of impartation on what Jada had. And see, some of you, listen, the Lord is going to start answering the prayers you've been praying, those radical prayers. And listen, when he starts tapping in the middle of the night like Jada, we have to be those who, we don't want to be like the Shulamite and say, well, I've already got my robe, I got my slippers, I'm into bed, come on, I done my hair. We just got to say, here am I, send me, amen? So let's do this. Let's welcome Pastor John as well.
Amen. Good stuff.
Jesus.
You love him tonight?
Yeah.
Amen. Father, we thank you. We just thank you that you love us. We thank you that you care so much about us.
Yes, Lord.
Hallelujah.
Jesus.
You know, there's a difference between knowing God loves you and knowing that you're loved by him. It's just such an honor and a privilege to know that our Father loves us. There's nothing that we can ever do that'll make him love us more. And there's nothing we can ever do that'll make us love him less.
Amen.
He absolutely is madly in love with us.
Come on.
Jeez. Hallelujah. You know, I absolutely love him. I'm so grateful for everything that he's doing for me. I don't know about you guys, but I've been in a struggle. I've been in a fight with some things. And I was driving to my son's house Sunday on the way to church. And I was just praying. I was by myself, and I was just in the truck by myself, and I was just talking to the Lord. And I said, Lord, I don't understand kind of some of the things I'm going through. You know, you got some faith, man. When Jason's praying for you, you know, you got a person with a gift of faith that's praying. And I don't want to exalt him above everybody else, but I mean, you know what I mean. Everybody's praying for me, and I'm so grateful for everybody who's been praying for me and continue to pray for me. And I was praying on the way to work, on the way to church, and I told the Lord, I said, Lord, I don't understand things, but I just know that you love me. And the Lord spoke to me very candidly. And I like when the Lord speaks to you, and sometimes it sits real well with you, and sometimes it challenges you. And the Lord said, John, you're focusing too much on what I'm not doing.
than what I am doing. That's a kick in the gut. Because I was focusing more on what he wasn't doing, how Jason's prayer wasn't being answered, how other people who were praying for me, that prayers were not, I wasn't seeing breakthrough. I wasn't seeing what I was praying for happen. And the Lord said, I want you to go and I want you to write down everything that you're seeing that I'm doing. So I began to write down things that I began to see that I seen the Lord was moving in, whether he was moving in my life or whether he was moving in someone else's life or what he was doing over across the nations or what he was doing in the world. And he said, I want you to begin to become thankful over what I am doing. I want you to begin to be faithful or grateful for what is happening in the earth by what I'm orchestrating and I'm moving. And what has happened is this, it's took my eyes and focus, because how many knows whatever you focus on grows in your life. And I began to take my focus off of what wasn't happening and what wasn't going on. And no, everything's not worked out the way I want it to work out right now. But I know one thing for certain, that I believe the Lord is working all things out for my good. I know that God is working everything out for what he's got purpose and he's got plan for my life. And it may not look the way that I want it to look. It may not look the way you want it to look. But I know one thing, and one thing for certain is this, is that he will never leave me and he will never forsake me. He is absolutely good all the time. And we have to make a firm foundation in our lives. This foundational truth has to be there. Because if we don't, we'll question why some things don't happen and some things don't come to pass and some things don't work out the way we want them to work out. We have to have a firm foundation that God is absolutely good. That if there's something happening in our lives that's not good, it's not working out, it's not happening in our heart, in our lives, if there's pain in our hearts or pain in our lives and some form of fashion. Sickness is not sent to teach us a lesson. It's not sent to teach us something that we've done wrong. And it doesn't matter if I've sowed seed for it. It don't matter that, because I get to reap what Jesus sowed. Hallelujah. I don't have to worry about reaping what I sowed, because I've tapped into the fact that there's royal blood that flows in my vein now. There's something. Listen, I know one thing. The doctor may say we have diabetes, but there's blood that is royal that flows through my veins that cannot have sugar diabetes in it. Gout cannot live in my body, because the blood of Jesus speaks a better word than that. Then sickness can't live in our bodies, because the blood speaks a better word than that. And we've got to have a firm foundation that the blood does speak a better word, no matter what our circumstances may look like, no matter how difficult it may seem, no matter how hard it may come, no matter how big the mountain may look. We've got to have a firm foundation that God is absolutely good. And I'm grateful that he's good. Hallelujah. I don't need the stool. It's okay if I haven't preached this whole year here. I sat over the other day, the Lord said, would it be okay if you didn't speak all year? I said, whew. I'm so glad Pastor texted me and asked me to speak, because that was a tough one for me to answer. How many knows it's your season? Amen. Last night as I began to type this out, this is kind of what I felt like the Lord spoke to me about, not only my life, but I believe he's speaking to us as a body. I believe that we're entering a season of great fruitfulness in every area of our lives. I believe things that have felt like they have been withheld for whatever reason will begin to pour into our lives. And this will be a release that will enable us to take territory that has been held by the enemy for generations. We will see the things that we have prayed and fasted for over the last decade begin to be released to the church in this hour. The line between the natural and the spiritual will become paper thin. And we will reach one hand into heaven and the other hand in the darkest regions of the earth and pull them together. This is a time where the reaper will overtake plowman, and we will see answers to prayer as soon as we speak them out of our mouths. This is a season that you have waited your whole life for, and you will not be denied, you will not be detoured, and you will not even be delayed any longer, because this is your season.
This is what we've waited our whole existence for. This is what the prophets looked into the future for. This is what they dreamed about. This is what they longed for, that we are entering into a season where the glory of God is going to rest upon us so heavily, just like my sister just preached about. Yes, we're going to see it and we're going to experience it because we've said yes. The Holy Spirit asked me today. He said, John, can I have your absolute yes? Can I have your yes to whatever I have called you to be, whatever I've destined you to go to? Whatever I have purposed in my life for you to do, can I have your absolute yes? And I'm telling you right now, I believe with everything in me that that is what the call to the church is today. Will you say yes in the midnight hour when he looks to you and says, can you get up and pray? Will you intercede for this nation? Amen. Will you be the one that is stand between the living and the dead? Will you be the man or the woman that will say, not on my watch, not on my time, not on the time, oh, Rabashikarabasete. It's not going to be on my watch, not my God. America will not die and go to hell on my watch. We will see the glory of the Lord. Hey, we'll see it cover the earth like the waters cover the sea. It will happen in my generation. I'm not looking for something that's going to happen next generation or the generation that's going to come. I'm thankful for what they're going to see, but I got to see something in my generation. I got to see something that I prayed and longed for. I got to see something that I fasted for, that I believed God for, and I will not back down, walk away. I will not be detoured, delayed, or denied. I have made my mind up that it is now. It's not tomorrow. It's not next year. It's now. Today is the day of salvation. Will you not hearken to the voice of the Lord? Now is our season. Now is our season. Now is what you prayed for. Now is what you fasted for. Now is what you had that pit bull mentality of faith that you grabbed a hold of something and you said, I'm not going to let go of it. I know it may not. Listen, we got to make our mind up that the word of God speaks clearer and it speaks more true than anything that we may be encompassing in our lives or we may be seeing happen in our hearts and our lives right now, that the word does speak better. Hallelujah. It does speak something to us and we've got to know without a shadow of a doubt that I'm not backing up. I'm not running away. I'm not going to give up, not giving in. I'm not going to run. Hallelujah. I'm not going to look like a dog running with his tail between its legs. I'm not going to run away from the mountain because I spoke to the mountain one time and it didn't move. I'm going to keep speaking, but while I'm speaking, I'm going to grab something. I'm going to walk up a mountain until it does move because I'm not going to allow that mountain to delay me. I'm not going to let it to detour me, and I'm sure not going to let it stop me. Come on. Yeah. You receive that? It is our season. It's Kingsway season. Come on. It's your season. Psalm chapter 1. I thought Pastor Jody was going to go ahead and talk all my scriptures tonight. But that's all right. It's such an honor to have him and his family a part of our house. Such an honor. I've loved his heart from the moment I spoke to him. Is that rain?
Yeah.
Yeah. Psalms 1, verse 1 through 3 in the New King James reads this way. Blessed is the man who walks not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor stands in the path of sinners, nor sits in the seat of the scornful, but his delight is in the law of the Lord, and in his law he meditates day and night. He shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of water, that brings forth its fruit in its season. Somebody say, it's my season. whose leaf also shall not wither, and whatever he does shall prosper. Hallelujah. Somebody said it's time for prosperity, right? Come on, the word blessed means happy. And the word ungodly, now most people would think that that word just means sinner, someone who's a sinful person. And it does mean wicked, but the one thing that caught my attention was it meant to be morally wrong. And I believe that we have to guard ourselves from taking advice from anyone that is not living from the place of faith that we need advice from. Some people would try to give advice from their place of their personal experience instead of the foundation of the Word of God. And I don't know about you, but when you're in a problem and you're having issues, you don't need somebody who has issues trying to give you advice about the reason why they ain't come through their issue. You need somebody that's going to allow the Word of God to speak greater than any circumstance you may be living in. You have to understand that there's got to be something that has to resonate in your body. See, I don't know about you, but I've been in a fight over my destiny over the last 5 months. There's been a strong attack that's come against my purpose and my destiny. But I do understand one thing for certain, that the blood does speak a better word. And I do understand that I've made my mind up that I'm going to delight myself in God's word, and I'm not going to allow anything or anyone to speak louder than the truth that is in God's word. I'm not going to allow pain to speak truth. I'm not going to allow pain to speak louder. There's times when I get up in the morning and it's difficult to make it out the door. There's times when I've got to hobble to the bathroom. But you know what? I don't allow that pain to speak louder than the fact that Jesus said, "By my stripes you are healed." I'm not going to allow that word, that pain, to speak louder than the fact that Jesus or the psalmist declared that he sent his word and he healed them. There's sometimes I gotta mutter that word to myself. There's sometimes I gotta utter it to myself and I gotta meditate on it. I gotta spend time alone with God as I'm driving down the road, and it's difficult. Listen, I can only preach out of my own experience. I don't know about you, but there's sometimes when the word of God doesn't work out sometimes for me and for the moment, but I do know that it's working a greater glory for me. And I just have to say, you know what? I'm going to meditate on this, and I'm going to stand on it. I'm going to believe it. I'm going to delight myself. I'm going to pleasure myself in the word. I'm going to desire the word. I'm going to long for it. I'm going to speak it. I'm going to utter it, and I'm going to mutter it. One of the definitions in the Hebrew is the word growl. And one of the Greek lexicon, one of the lexicons, or one of the Hebrew lexicons, it said this. It said it would be like a lion standing over its prey. It would growl over its prey. And there are some times when you stand on the promises of God, it does feel like you've got to have this growling mentality, that the enemy's going to come in and try to steal that, like a prey that's going to try to steal your food or steal the word, the promise of God that's in your life. But you got to stand over it and growl over it and say, you know what? I may not see it come to fruition this week, but I know God's going to come. It's going to come to pass sooner or later, because God's word doesn't come back void. But it does accomplish what it's set forth to do. He said, as the rain comes down, as the snow waters the earth, he said, my word will not come back void. So I looked at him. I got to hurry. I looked at, there's five benefits. Five benefits to meditating of the word. And they're all listed here in verse. In verses 1 through 3, the first benefit is to be like a tree. The second benefit is to be planted by rivers of water. The third benefit brings forth its fruit in its season. The fourth benefit is that leaf will not wither. And the fifth benefit is whatever he does will prosper. Isaiah 61:3 was the other scripture that Jody tried to steal from me. It says, to console those who mourn in Zion, to give them beauty for ashes, the oil of joy for mourning, the garment of praise for the spirit of heaviness, that they may be called trees of righteousness, the planting of the Lord, that he may be glorified. I believe that there's too many times believers spend too much time trying to change the fruit of the tree instead of changing the tree itself. I don't care how much time you try to make an apple grow oranges, it's not gonna grow oranges. I don't care how much time you spend trying to make an orange tree grow an apple, it's not going to produce apple. And there's so many times in the believer's life we're too focused on trying to inspect the fruit that's happening in our lives instead of changing the tree. Instead of just understanding that we've become a tree of righteousness because of Him. The scripture says that we've been justified by faith according to Romans chapter 5. I don't know about you, but that really taught me something when I grabbed a hold of what justification really meant. When there was a double imputation, that when He took His righteousness and placed it upon me, and I placed my sin upon Him, and I live from that very moment, from that place. I can never be re-justified. I can never receive justification more than one time. When I come to Him and I receive Him as Savior, I've been absolutely justified and I've been absolutely made righteous. There's no more making me more righteous. I'm absolutely righteous. And in the moment that I understand that my tree has been made righteous, and I'm not trying to just be taking care of the fruit. I'm just taking care of the tree, because the tree will produce fruit because it just produces fruit. Right? Makes sense, doesn't it? Makes a lot of sense to me. But it says we'll be planted by the rivers of water. Yeah. To plant means to put or set in the ground for growth. It's only that after you discover you're a tree of righteousness that you are positioned properly to grow. We are supposed to grow from glory to glory. We're supposed to, how many knows God is a progressive God? He's not a digressive God. It's the reason why He said 30, 60, 100. It's the reason why He said fruit, more fruit, much fruit. According to John chapter 15, He's progressively moving us into greater things. Amen. Let's take an inventory of your life and to know that last year at this time, where were we? I mean, this coming Sunday will be my first year anniversary being a part of Kingsway, and I'm so honored to be here. I can look over the last year and I can see where God has brought me from and what God has done in my life and how He's purposed and positioned me for what he's going to do 20 years down the road. This last year was instrumental. Very instrumental. And I'm thankful. I'm hoping the power doesn't go out. I heard that happen Sunday. Come on. Hey, I think I can get loud enough. Everybody in here can hear me anyway. But notice something here. He said we'd be planted by the rivers of water. He didn't say we'd be planted by a river of water. I think we have to be very cognizant of the fact that God wants us to drink from different fountains. He wants us to be able to receive, because there's been people that God wanted me to receive from that I shut off because immediately I didn't agree with them. I don't know about you, but I used to be a really judgmental person. Well, if it didn't look like me, act like me, speak like me, think like me, then it wasn't God, because I was the one that knew how God thought. I've learned that. Well, never mind. I never would have stayed here, because there's some thinking that's stretched. The Lord stretched me so much, and God, it's been so good. Man, it's such a good place to be. Jeremiah 3:15 says that I will give you shepherds according to my heart, who will feed you with knowledge and understanding. And I don't know about you, but I'm so grateful for the shepherds that we have here at Kingsway. That we have shepherds here that truly are in touch with the heart of the Father. that's truly in touch with what the Father's saying and what He's releasing. And it starts with our head. It starts with our senior pastor, but it doesn't stop with our senior pastor. It flows all the way down through our pastoral team, even to the people, because we are raising up people who are hungry after the heart of the Father, that are hungry after what He's saying and what He's doing and what He's releasing, that we are not going to be a people who are satisfied with where we are right now, that we're not satisfied with our revelation of who God is at this moment, because we always know that as the angels circle around Him, they're seeing all new sides of His face. And we know that there's times when we're going to walk through that from this time and next year at this time, I'm going to know the Father differently than I know Him right now, because He's going to reveal things to us. But He uses pastors to do that, and He uses great men and women of God to speak into our lives. And we've got to know that there's so many rivers that He wants us to drink from, and we can't just get locked into one river and think that one river is the only river. We can't get locked into one river and say that's the only way God moves. Because listen, I don't know about you, but I like the way Bill Johnson says it. He says, God will never, he'll never offend His word. He'll never come contrary to His word, but He doesn't mind offending your understanding of the word. And listen, there's going to be so many times that God's going to speak through some river that you didn't even think was a river. There's been times when God's used people that I didn't even think had even knowledge of who God was, that He would speak through them to me. And as I would leave, the Lord would say, did you catch that? See, before I came here, I didn't think God spoke through signs, and I didn't think God spoke through billboards. So I don't know about, see, those stretching. Listen, I don't know about you, but I used to think people like you were fruity. Good fruit, though. Absolutely. Come on now. But I mean, there was no way I ever thought God would have spoke to me through a license plate. And all of a sudden, I'll drive up and I'll be wondering about something. I'll look over the license plate, and that license plate will be saying exactly what I'm thinking about. I'm like, okay, Lord, You're right. So don't get caught up thinking that you're the only river. I think a lot of times in the prophetic church, that's one of the downfalls, is we feel like we're the only ones that haven't heard the voice of the Lord. And we can't receive from people who are not quite spirit-filled. And I'm just going to leave that there. Just understand that God wants us to drink from different rivers. Amen. Jeremiah 17:7-8 says, blessed is the man who trusts in the Lord and whose hope is in the Lord, for he shall be like a tree planted by the waters, which spreads out its roots by the river and will not fear when heat comes, but his leaf will be green, and will not be anxious in the year of drought, nor will cease from yielding fruit. It's a place of unending yielding of fruit. And now I want to go to my main point. I got 12 minutes. Jeremiah told me to get out about 8:30. That's not going to happen. He said we bring forth our fruit in a season. The Hebrew definition of the word season is time. In Ephesians chapter 5, verses 15 and 16. It says, see then that you walk circumspectly. In other words, keep your eyes open. Don't go through life with your eyes closed all the time. Open your eyes. He says, not as fools, but as wise. Redeeming the time because the days are evil. There are two Greek words for time. One is chronos, and one is kairos. Chronos, which is where we get our word chronological from, watches and calendars operate on chronos time. And my Greek is probably pretty bad. That may not be the way you say it. But that's how I'm going to say it from a country boy from
Well, from Alabama. Here and gone, named after a Greek god named Kronos that would eat his children. Has anybody ever felt like time was just being eaten up right in front of you? Like, I was talking to a friend last night that I haven't spoken to in several years. And we were talking about, I guess it's Facebook official now, our son Ben's expecting a son, or I said son. Well, I prophesied that. He's expecting a child. I did walk in their house the other day, and they had a list of names, and I had to jot John down there. But he's expecting his first child. Amen. But I was talking to him, and I said something about that. He said, "Man, you sure are getting old." I said, "Man, you're 3 weeks older than me." And I said, "Man, can you imagine that? I mean, really, seriously. I mean, we're about to come up on close to our 25th anniversary from our graduation class." I'm like, "Man, I remember when we just couldn't get through school. I mean, it's like, man, it's like school was never going to end." And all of a sudden, now we're coming close to this year's reunion. It's not quite 25. I graduated in 94, so that's 23, close. But it's like all of a sudden time, you know, as you're young, older people tell you, you know, when you get older, time just kind of speeds up. You don't believe that when you're young, when it takes like 2 years for Christmas to get here. But when you're the one buying Christmas, then, woo, it happens every other month. It's just the way you feel. So we all can identify with the fact that time sometimes just seems like it's getting eaten up in front of us. You look up and bam, you're 40. And then you look up and bam, I haven't gotten that far yet. Too much past 40. But we have a pastor turning 40 this year. Right? He's just a young guy. Young guy. But so we see time that's just being eaten up. Paul, in writing this text, did not use the word chronos when he wrote about time. Because how many knows it's impossible to redeem chronos time? He instead uses this other Greek word, the word kairos. Doesn't use chronos, he uses kairos. And kairos is an ancient Greek word meaning the right or opportune moment. It means the supreme moment. Kairos moments are special moments not defined by or controlled by chronos moments. His purposes transcend chronos time. We live in the spirit and are in tune with kairos time. Even if there are divine appointments in our lives that we miss, how many believes that you miss some moments? That God is able to redeem those times because they're kairos moments. They're these supreme moments. There's these opportune moments, the right moments, that God's able to redeem those moments and bring them back to us. God help me. God can redeem the kairos out of our past and bring it to our present to define our future. A kairos moment is a moment in time when the Holy Spirit draws near to do a special work, and through a person or a group, the Holy Spirit creates and orchestrates kairos moments. A kairos moment is God's appointed time to act. Yes. Kingsway Church is at a kairos moment, and it's time for us to act. Amen. That's why we're preparing now through pathways. See anything I was going to be able to bring that around there? During this week, we're preparing to find out how you can plug in to help find your kairos moment at Kingsway. To help Kingsway further its kairos moment It's redeemed time. He can redeem. Listen, I don't care where you've been. I don't care what you've been through. I don't care how old you are or how young you are. He's able to redeem every moment. He's able to bring it back to its original state, its original intended purpose. He brings us back to that place. That's what redemption means anyway, right? Amen. When we were redeemed by the blood of Jesus Christ, he didn't just fix the old. I'm thankful that God's not into just fixing and repairing the old man. But he absolutely created a brand new man. He established me again back in the same place Adam was in the beginning of time when he was absolutely alone with the Father. He put me back in that and gave us the same exact instructions that he gave Adam. He said, extend the borders of my kingdom. Yep. This is your season. This is your Kairos moment. The other two benefits was your leaf does not wither. And I believe that this speaks to the fact that we will never go through a season of burnout. That as we meditate on the Word of God, as we utter the Word, and as we stay longing for it, connected to it, and speaking it, and believing it, that we will never go, when we begin to, as the Scripture says, as we begin to drink, as we begin to allow ourselves to be planted by the rivers, and we begin to bring forth fruit, and as that fruit begins to be, as the Scripture says, as we begin to be purged, we bring forth more fruit, so that we can learn to abide, so that we can bring forth much fruit, and as we go through that process of all that, that we will never go through a season where we get burned out producing fruit. It was never intended for you to minister out of the lack that's in your life. You are always supposed to minister out of the overflow that's in your heart. And if you're ministering out of the overflow of your heart, you never can get burned out. And then whatever he does shall prosper, I believe speaks to everything that we do will succeed and be profitable. Every word that you speak will be profitable to the hearers of it. Yes. Amen? Yes. Amen. Father, we thank you for all that you're doing in our lives. We thank you. We thank you just that you're a good Father. And Father, we bless you for this great season that we are entering into, the season of no lack, the season of abundance, the season of no burnout. But yet, Lord, we're going to see the season that we dreamed about, the season that we've journaled about, the season that we've prophesied about, the season that we've received words over. This is our season. And Father, we surrender it to you. And yes, Lord, as we say, as a family, as a body together, you have our absolute yes. You have our uprising and our downsetting. Father, you have everything. And God, we give you honor for that in Jesus' name. Come on, Pastor.
Amen. Good word. Strong. Come on, those are some good words tonight, aren't they? How many of you like how it all kind of wove together? You know, and I didn't know what, all I knew was John's title, It's Your Season. Had no idea it was going to tie in with A Time to Prosper. You know, Jada's word, you know, and about being able to come underwater and to be able to walk in the glory that God wants to give. And then all of a sudden, God begins to start allowing the heavens to confirm the word. Amen. And so I just think it's right for us tonight to say, let it be unto us according to your word. Amen. Come on, let's declare, say, it's my season. I want to go wherever the glory wants to take me. And it's my time to prosper in Jesus' name. Amen. We love you guys. Ladies, don't forget about Women's Bible Study this Friday. And please do go ahead and relieve the King's Kids workers. Let them know how much you appreciate them back there. They're back there tending to the seeds that God has sown so they can grow up into all that God has created them to be. We love you. Hey, and bring a friend on Sunday to this Pathways class. It's going to be awesome. Chicken and dumplings.